Mark chapter number 14. That is the right verse. I did say that right. Mark 14, verse number 1. The Bible says in Mark chapter 14 and verse number 1, after 2 days was the feast of the Passover and of unleavened bread, and the chief priests and the scribes sought how they might take him by craft and put him to death. But they said, not on the feast day, lest there be an uproar of the people. Verse number 3 says, and being in Bethany, in the house of Simon the leper, as he sat at meat, there came a woman having an alabaster box of ointment of spikenard, very precious. And she brake the box and poured it on his head. There were some that had indignation within themselves and said, why was this waste of the ointment made? For it might have been sold for more than 300 pence and have been given to the poor. And they murmured against her. And Jesus said, let her alone. Why trouble ye her? She hath wrought a good work on me. For ye have the poor with you always, and whensoever ye will, ye may do them good. But me ye have not always. She hath done what she could. She has come aforehand to anoint my body to the burying. Verily I say unto you, wheresoever this gospel shall be preached throughout the whole world, this also that she hath done shall be spoken of for a memorial of her. Verse number 10 says, and Judas Iscariot, one of the 12, went unto the chief priests to betray him unto them. And when they heard it, they were glad and promised to give him money. And he sought how he might conveniently betray him. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Our Father in heaven, we come before you once again this morning. God, we want to prepare our hearts for the preaching of God's word. God, we ask that you would speak to our hearts, that you would have free reign through the message. God, I pray that you'd be with Pastor. I pray that you'd use him in a mighty way. God, I pray that you'd help us to be listeners this morning, but to not just hear the word, but to do it. God, I pray that you be pleased in these things. It's in Jesus' name we pray and ask all these things. Amen. You may be seated.
Lord, you had the splendor of heaven, a crown, a robe, and a throne. So what kind of love would lead you to leave the safety of that kind of home? I know that you willingly suffer, but why would you suffer for me? I know what I am, and I don't understand how I could be worth Calvary. When you knew I was lost, and you knew that a cross was the price you'd have to pay. When we cried, crucify, Lord, you didn't have to die, but you did it anyway. Now I'll never see what you saw in me, 'cause you knew I would never be perfect. But I'm just so glad that somehow you thought I was worth it. Lord, sometimes I feel like a vessel, just useless old pieces of clay. But somehow you saw more, something worth dying for. You paid more than you should have paid. When you knew I was lost, and you knew that a cross was the price you'd have to pay. When we cried, crucify, Lord, didn't have to die, but you did it anyway. Now I'll never see what you saw in me, 'cause you knew I would never be perfect. But I'm just so glad that somehow you thought I was worth it. Now I'll never see what you saw in me, 'cause you knew I would never be perfect. But I'm just so glad that somehow you thought I was worth it.
Thank you, Pastor Josh, for that wonderful song. We've been seeing those truths as we've been looking in the Gospel of Mark. We've been studying Mark for a while, and we've seen some rock-solid truths. We've seen that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Amen. We've seen the goodness of God revealed to us through Jesus Christ. And then we've seen through that, if we apply those truths to our life, we can have a rock-solid life in these sandy times. So now, in Mark chapter 14, the cross is now in sight. We are getting close as we are here to Easter and also Good Friday. We see the end is nigh. Jesus is having a meal, as Pastor Josh had read here for us, and some woman comes in and just ruins the meal. I mean, put yourself there for a moment. She comes in, she has a very potent bottle of perfume ointment, a very smelly stuff, breaks the thing, pours it on Jesus in the middle of the meal. Do you realize how terrible that is to a meal? Yeah, I don't know if you're getting this here, but I remember one time my wife and I, just years ago, before I was the pastor, we actually went out to eat with the pastor in one of my favorite restaurants. I love you have a good breakfast at Bob Evans. That's what we were doing. And there was no one there at Bob Evans. It was awesome. And we get to Bob Evans, and we're in a corner booth, and we're visiting, having a great time, and one person comes in, this lady comes in, and she sits down in the booth next to us. And I mean, her perfume was so thick, you could cut it with a knife. And I got my pancakes, my eggs, my bacon, and I'm trying to eat it, and every time I open up my mouth, I can taste her perfume. You know what I'm talking about? And then it was like we're the only people in the whole restaurant, and we had to get the waitress like, hey, can you move us? And then, of course, that was a whole ordeal, you know? I mean, how wasteful, man. It stunk the whole place up. Just ruined everything, you know? And I know you're looking at me going, wait a minute, that's not the context of the story. All right, get off your high horse. You know how this ends, right? But I'll be honest with you. Right now, if somebody did that, you'd be like, who is that? Who has that smell? What is that? I know this for a fact because I like a clean church. And one of my favorite things, I don't want the look clean, I want the smell clean. I like to mop the lobby, and a lot of times what I do just for extra special moppiness is I like to put a little pine salve in there. Let me tell you, pine salve smells so good. It smells clean, like bleach. And I had a few of the ladies in the church going, oh, what is that? I'm like, it's called clean. It's amazing, you know? Oh, it's so bad. Oh, it's whatever it is. So get the understanding here. If this happened here, somebody come in, broke a bottle of perfume, dumped it on you, you'd be like, hey, what did I do to you? What is this? Of course, we know the story. We've read this through. And in fact, this anointing is one of three. This is actually the last of three that we see happen in the Gospels here. Early on in the Gospel of Luke, Jesus talks about a very sinful woman. They believe she was a prostitute. She anointed Jesus' feet, wiped them with her hair. That's not this account. And then we find before the triumphal entry, before Palm Sunday, there was another lady. This is in the Gospel of John, which is called Mary of Bethany. This is Lazarus' sister. She comes in. I believe it's the same bottle that we're reading about right here. She opens it. She also anoints his feet. And the disciples are like, ah, 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 you know. So then this time comes in. It's a very fitting time with Matthew and Mark go together on this one. They record this time, this specific instance. And disciples already been through this now. This is the third time. And they're like, man, will somebody get that away from that woman? She comes in, she breaks the bottle, she pours on his head this time and anoints him. And you know, for one disciple, that was the last straw. Disciples had a They were mad. It says when it talks about indignation, that really means that they saw this as being so unfair, they were angry about it. And they saw this great value, and they got mad at her. Jesus had a whole different perspective, praise God. So I believe as I was studying this, I was asking the Lord what he'd have for us. One word today, legacy. I like verse 9. Jesus says, "Verily I say unto you," he says, "wheresoever the gospel shall be preached throughout the whole world, this also that she hath done shall be spoken for a memorial of her." That's incredible. What a gift. Here's the disciples, and every human flesh in that room is like, oh, come on, why did you? We could have done so good with this, and you just stunk up the whole place, and now this has happened. And Jesus says, hey, stop. This is for a memorial. We're going to remember her. Wherever the gospel is, man, what a legacy to leave. I was thinking about that. What are people going to say about you after you're gone? What are they going to say at your funeral when they get behind the microphone and they talk about you? What are they going to say? What are they going to remember you? Because most of the time, even if you're alive, you bring up somebody. Hey, do you know Pastor Josh Alexander? And there's usually a one-sentence phrase that'll come right after that. Oh, yeah, good guy. He can preach. Oh, yeah. Hey, you know what? You guys know Brother Ron Baker. Oh, yeah, the tall guy, right? Like, what do people, when they describe you, when you're not around, how do they describe you? My wife knows when I preached around a lot before COVID, I was always introduced the exact same way to every church, every school, everywhere I preached, it always introduced me the same way. And it wasn't terrible, don't get me wrong, but it always convicted my heart that's like, really, this is what I'm known for? Like, this is, oh, Pastor Todd, that guy. And I thought, man, how much I want to change that around. And it was always this. I'd like to introduce and speak to you for the first time. This is out of Oxbow Baptist Church. This is Pastor Chris Todd. He ran 100 miles. Listen, there's worse things to be known for, right? And of course, that was so long ago. It's like, did I run 100 miles, you know? Yeah, that was a whole lifetime ago. That was another life ago. But I thought, you know, after I'm gone, and my kids look back at their dad, they say, remember Dad? Yeah. He ran 100 miles once. Then they have children, and their children get a little older. They say, tell us about Grandpa. What did Grandpa do? What was he like? Oh, he ran 100 miles once. It's not bad. I mean, don't get me wrong. I wish it was better. The Bible says a great name is to be chosen for great riches. I want to leave a good name. The Bible says a great name is like a sweet ointment, better than good ointment. It's a good smell. And so that name is mentioned, and all of a sudden, oh yeah. You ever smell a good nostalgic smell, and it just takes you back to a happier time? Like, that's what I want. After I'm gone, even now, when somebody brings up my name, that's what I want. I want to leave that legacy behind. You know, I spent maybe 20 years of my life at this church. I hope I am known for more than just running one time. It's really easy to do. It's left foot, right foot, repeat until finish. I mean, it's not rocket science, okay? I really wish there was something more. And look at this woman's legacy. I think this is really incredible. And again, I believe that she is the same Mary of Bethany. It really doesn't change the story around. I can tell you why that is. But in here in the story, we're not told who she is. But we find out that this legacy she's leaving, this memorial, is bigger than her life. It says the whole world. When this gospel goes out to the whole world, in every language, of every tribe, and every tongue, this woman has a great memorial, a legacy left that we're going to talk about, even today, because we're still talking about her today. It's longer than her life. To the end of this age, no matter what, so 2,000 years, and here we are, still talking about her and what she had did. I want to challenge us today, and I hope that's something that means something to you. What does your name mean? I know in this day and age, it's not as important as it used to be. You know, it used to be handshake was good enough because I can trust that person. And nowadays, it's all about just cutting throats to get to the top and get power and get popularity and get wealth and all those things. And those don't leave very good legacies. Only what we can do for Christ, the people are going to remember. I've done so many funerals in my life. I cannot tell you how many I've done. And the things I always hear are, They were a gracious person, a loving person. They would give you the shirt off their back. Those are the things that people remember when you helped them, when you did something. I want to take this morning and look exactly what she has done. She did something. She did something that rewarded her with an eternal memorial. Something left behind for your children, your grandchildren, and your great-great-grandchildren, and so on. Because if the Lord tarries is coming, nowadays we have 23andMe ancestry. Everybody's real interested. You can go back further than you ever have before. And when they see your name, I hope it's more than just a birth date, a death date, and maybe a married date in between. What is that sentence after your name? What is that smell that enters into people's thoughts when your name is brought up? I'm going to challenge us there today. We'll look at three things, I believe, and we'll make some application that we saw that she did, because it says what she hath done. She did something. And first, if we want to look at what she has done, I'm going to put number one, that she did what was fitting. She did what was fitting. Now, what does she do? The Bible says that she had an alabaster box. Alabaster is a really kind of a neat thing. Alabaster is kind of like the same thing you'd look at of a stalagmite or a stalactite coming down, more of a clear stone. It's earth. It's earthen, okay? When you break it, like she broke it. Some say she broke the seal, but I believe the text really tells us she broke the neck right off the bottle this time. This was it. She was going ahead and pour out the rest of it. But it's an earth brittle. It can be broken. But then the spikenard is what's in it. That's what's really interesting. It's called spikenard. Spikenard is really an interesting thing. If you hear spikenard in the Bible, spikenard's talking about the gold standard. Like if you're going to have perfumes, if you're going to have a good, you know, smell, so you want to, you know, impress your wife back in biblical times, and you get her spikenard, you can't do any better. This is the best. This is a kingly smell. In fact, most of the time in the Bible, if you were to search in your concordance, spikenard, you know what book of the Bible has it the most? It's the Song of Solomon. And of course, Song of Solomon usually only comes out, usually at couples retreats, you know? It's pretty graphic. I got a lot of teens here today, too. I won't, you know, go into it too deep, but I can give you guys this little bonus if you want this. Song of Solomon, you know Solomon, he had like 1,000 wives, right? He knew how to pick up girls. Do you guys, if you guys are taking notes, I can give you some of his pickup lines. They're in Song of Solomon. He said, see if I remember this. He's talking to this woman he's wooing in song, and he says, "Your hair is like a flock of goats from Gilead." I won't say it. I don't want to get too close to my wife. I don't want her to overheat over there, you know. You guys write that down? "Your teeth are like a flock of shorn lambs." I know. Whoa. Ready for this one? "Your neck is like a strong tower of David." Listen, guys, use that carefully, okay? With great power comes great responsibility. You tell a girl her neck is a tower of David. And through this whole time, now listen, that's the level the Song of Solomon is. Like, that's the level where Solomon's like, "I'm the king, and honey, you beautiful." And he's wooing her, man. He knew how to get girls. And what was his preference? What was his smell? What was his ointment? It was spikenard. The same stuff we have here. In fact, when they crack the tomb of King Pharaoh Tutankhamun, guess what the smell was? Spikenard. He had a big, you can actually Google it, it's a big old vase, and it had spikenard in it, because that is the gold standard. That is it. Now, what is spikenard? Spikenard comes from a plant. It's got really prickly roots, spikes, spikenard, only found in the hills of Himalaya. This is what we're talking about here. There's American spikenard and Egyptian, but this is where they would have got it from, is Himalaya. It's really important. It's really powerful. And what's really interesting about this is it has some properties that we still use it for today. Spikenard is actually, they believe it has some anti-anxiety type of properties to it. It has some anti-inflammatory properties to it. And it also, they find, is really good for your lung health. the breathe, the break up the congestion, or whatever it is. It's kind of a really interesting thing. And we find here how much she dumped out. In fact, in here it says it really would have been about a year's wages worth. So here's a year's wage of an average person that she had in a bottle. I mean, this would have been, if I have anything in my life that's a year's worth of my wages, I mean, this is treasure. But she takes it, she breaks off the neck, and she pours it on Jesus. And this is spikenard. This is an alabaster. And I kind of think it's really interesting here to see the picture here, this earthen vessel filled with something so kingly, so sweet, so perfect. What a picture of Christ right there that's broken. The only way to get the sweet-smelling savor out of that, to anoint him. Of course, that's not the point here, but I think it's very fitting here. You know, so you look at this, and disciples see this, and maybe we're with them here now. We're like, whoa, man, we could have sold that. We could have built our new building. We could get our car fixed. We could get all these things taken care of. And you just broke it and dumped it out all willy-nilly, as if it's just an impulse. I just decided to do it. I just decided to be wasteful today. And the disciples say, hey, why did you make this waste? Why did you waste this? Why would you have done that? Kind of interesting. I believe that when they say that, basically what they're saying is, Jesus, you're not good enough for my best. Because this is the best, and I've given it to Jesus. And they're saying, why was this waste made? I think it really shows their hearts. It shows Judas, at least, that, you know, he's not the best. And Jesus is the best, and he deserves your best. It's interesting that we understand, we were talking about running a little bit earlier, and Paul says, do you know that when you run a race, only one person gets a prize? The winner. He says, so here's our Christian life, our walk. We are all trying to do the best we can for Christ. But do you understand this, that only one person wins the prize in a race? And so what does Paul say? Run that you don't lose. Is that what he said? Did Paul say, run so that you finish average? Paul says, run that you may obtain. He says, run to win. He says, give your absolute best. Talking about running, when I was doing some long distances back in the early days of that, I remember I'd surround myself with people, go, whoa, that's pretty cool. I want to try that. And, you know, there's marathon running. So a marathon, y'all know how far a marathon is, right? Marathon's 26.2 miles. You want to know why it's 0.2 miles? Back there was a Olympics. It was in London. This is a long time ago. And the Queen wanted to see him through Buckingham Palace. She wanted to get out and see her. So they had to add that 0.2 to make you go around so the Queen can wave to you, you know. I'm sure the runners really love that. After 26 miles, do another quarter mile just to be able to get through that, you know. Anything beyond 26.2 technically is no longer a marathon. It is an ultra marathon. Now, people like that. Sounds cool, right? I mean, do you want to be a marathon runner or do you want to be an ultra runner, right? Ultra sounds like you have superpowers, right? So people would ask, what's the shortest amount I can run, and can I technically still be an ultra runner? If I run a marathon and then just go like this, 1 foot further, am I an ultra runner? If I do, and of course the next distance would be 50K. 50K is 30.1 miles. So if you have 30.1 miles, which is 5 miles, it's like basically a 5 mile cool down after a marathon. Am I technically an ultra runner? And I always get so aggravated when I hear those questions, because what I hear is this: I want the title, but I want to put in as little work as possible. Isn't that the mentality of today? And so I would say, no, that's ultra running is not about running the littlest, just running the furthest. Go 50 miles, go 100 miles. And they would say, why? Anything past 26.2 is a waste. What's the point? We see that philosophy in our world today. People want to get the absolute best by putting in the absolute least. It's amazing that we probably just a couple of years ago, right? We're like, hey, we got to bring up minimum wage. I'm not getting political here. This is just my own idiots talking, okay? You know, and it's like, well, you want to make more money, then make yourself worth more money. But it's interesting that the idea was, I don't want to do any more work. I just want more money. And now, man, McDonald's cost me like $23 for two meals yesterday, you know? It's expensive now. Why? Well, because they got to pay their staff so much now, you know? And people don't have the idea that, you know, and by the way, and so somebody who just says, I need to make more money, I'm going to work harder, take more responsibilities, the other people look at you and they go, why would you make that waste? Just sit and pout and cry about it and they'll give you more money, you know? Just go ahead and keep doing it. But you understand, that's our mentality today. I don't want to do anything. I don't want to run that I may obtain. I just want to run so I might finish maybe. But give me everything. I want it all. And they said, why? What waste that is. They don't understand that giving it all to make a difference for Christ, the world thinks it's a waste. It's funny, people aren't saved. They're like, so you have to go to church to go to heaven? No. Do you have to tithe and give your money to the church to go to heaven? No. Do you have to never swear and get rid of all the vices that are fun in this world and so you can go to heaven? No. Then why do you do those things? It's a waste. We say, no, because we love our Savior. We love our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I'm going to give my life to Him. I'm going to do the most I can do for Him. And they look at it and they go, what a waste. What a waste. Can I tell you something? This gift, what she did, I find it to be very fitting. If you want to leave a legacy, the only way you're going to be able to do that is by not phoning it in. Don't sit back and demand a legacy. Well, I tried, I guess, sometimes, and so therefore it was good enough. I did about as good as anybody else. But when you sit down and you say, no, I'm going to give it all. I'm going to run that I may obtain. Amen. I've seen finish lines running before, and all of a sudden I'm going really hard. I'm getting a little older, you know, and all of a sudden I'll start feeling that pinch in my chest. I'm like, I think I might have a heart attack. And I say, would it be worth it if I cross this finish line and win and still have a heart attack? And the answer is always yes, you know, and I haven't dropped dead yet. I'm just saying, if you want to obtain, be willing to give it all. I'm not saying this is a little, maybe you heard, I'm always going to talk about legacy today. This is going to be a little powder puff message. No, I'm saying this is a dangerous message. I'm saying, are you willing to put it all in? Are you willing to break the bottle and dump it out? Because once you've done that, there's no putting it back in the bottle and there's no putting the bottle back together. It's a very fitting thing if you're going to leave a sacrifice, if you're going to leave a legacy that's fitting. But also notice in verse 6, she did that which was good. In verse 6, Jesus said, don't leave her alone. Why trouble ye her? She hath wrought a good work. What made it good? I broke it down. Jesus said she did it unto him. You want to do a good work? Do something for Jesus today. She did it unto him. You know what? And they thought it was a waste. I can only imagine sometime. Now remember, this is hours before everything. This is when Jesus is getting ready to go before the council and the scourgings and ultimately the sacrifice of his life. And so he's got this whole ton of ointment dumped on his head, and he leaves and he goes out to the garden and he prays. And what does Luke tell us about that time he prays? The Bible says that he was sorrowful even unto death. And so he's praying, and he's praying so earnestly, and his spirit is so troubled that the Bible says his sweat glands, the capillaries broke, and he's now sweating blood down. I can only imagine in that moment when he is more troubled than any human has ever been troubled in the history of the universe, because he's facing something that is the worst possible outcome physically for anybody else, and he's God and he knows it's coming. What an incredible, we can never even understand what Jesus is going through. And I wonder, as the sweats are going through and the blood started mixing through, I just wonder if he could kind of smell that again. I'm not saying it, it has this anti-anxiety type of medication to it, so therefore it makes everything okay. I'm not saying that, but I'm saying maybe it helped. Maybe he smelt that and it brought him back to that moment where she did that. She sacrificed all for him because he's about ready to sacrifice all for them. The disciples said, what a waste. I wonder when Jesus went before the scourging and his hands are tied to a post and they got the whip with all the little pots and shards and little ball bearings, and they're putting them into his back and they're pulling his back back. And I just wonder, even in that moment, if maybe, just maybe a little bit, the flesh is tearing, that aroma would be kind of poofed out into the air when he was whipped. And he could kind of smell that again, that sweet, kingly smell. I wonder if maybe it was some of that little bit of the anti-inflammatory might have helped. I'm not saying it made it perfect. I'm just saying maybe it helped a little bit. Because she did what she could. She couldn't take away the suffering. She couldn't take away the pain. She couldn't, but she did what she could for him. I wonder when he hung on the cross, and we all know about the cross. We all know about the crucifixion. You don't die from bleeding. You don't die from exposure. You die from drowning, pretty much. You die because you can't breathe. You can't get air in your lungs. You hang there. And remember, your only support is nails in your hands. You got nails in your feet. And when you hang down like this, you can't get air out of your lungs. So you have to push up against that raw nail. It's a lung. You die because of lungs. I just wonder if maybe, just maybe a little bit, maybe that helped just a little bit as he was able to smell that. And maybe it just, even less than a 0.1%, maybe it just did something, but he could smell it and it could bring him back. But the disciples said, what a waste. Why waste all this? Verse 8 says she did what she could. God put in her heart and gave her the power of her hands to do something that she could actually do. Again, she couldn't take away the physical suffering, the mental suffering, the spiritual suffering, the actual death. She couldn't, but she did what she could. You know, we can't save everyone. Do you ever get overwhelmed in life trying to do good things? I do. I get overwhelmed. I need lists. If I get too many things going on my list, I just don't do anything. Is anyone else like me? I'm not very good a multitasker. Okay, I got to make this phone call. I got to talk to this person. I got to get ready for this mess. I got to go do it. And sometimes I get so many of them, and I just go, I'm not going to do anything today. I struggle with that. I think about the story of the boy walking on the beach. Big storm had come through, and there's all these starfish all laying out in the sand. Sun is now out. It's drying them out. I mean, the beach is full of them. A little boy takes one, tosses it in, sees another one, picks up, tosses it back in, but there's just millions of them. They're everywhere. And the man walks up to the little boy and says, what are you doing? Why are you wasting your time? He says, you can't make a difference here. Look how many there are. There's millions. There's tens of thousands. You can't make a difference. And the little boy picks up the starfish and says, I can make a difference with this one. Sometimes we got to step back and say, yeah, I know I can't save the world, but I can do what I can. God has given me the power to do some things that I can do. What can you do? Now, let me take a step back. God has placed us in a church. What if we all do the good that God put in our heart that we can do? I don't know if I can make an impact in White Lake, but I know we can. In Oakland County, if we just put the good, we can do what we can do. Because sometimes we look at it and say, it's too overwhelming. There's so many problems, there's so much pain, there's so much suffering, there's so much neglect, there's so much, what can we do? There's just, we're overwhelmed. Sometimes we go out to go soul winning. We meet on Saturdays. I think we're going to start meeting on Thursdays again. And it's like four of us. And there's like 33,000 people in our community. And we look at just us and we think, why are we even going out? Why are we doing this? And if we're not careful, we'll say we're wasting our time. And in fact, most doors will probably not be opened. Maybe out of each group that goes out, maybe talk to two or three people, and maybe one person might hear the gospel. In the grand scheme of things, does it even make a difference? Is it a waste? Why was this waste made? James 4 and verse 17 says, to him that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it's sin. When God's giving you good to do and put in your heart, do it. Why was this waste made? Well, I love the theologian that said, only one life will soon be passed. Only what's done for Christ will last. You want to leave a legacy. You want to leave a legacy that's a sweet-smelling ointment, a sweet-smelling savior to the air. You're going to have to do what is fitting, but you're going to have to do what you can. Do it unto Jesus. And do what is good. And I'm not saying that she did everything and all these things and she changed the whole course of the gospel, but I'm saying this, she did what she could and it was good. Thirdly, I'd like to share with you that she did what she did was faith-led. I love verse 8. She hath done what she could. She has come aforehand to anoint my body to the burying. Aforehand. I don't use that word. Do you use that word? Aforehand. Why are you doing that? Well, I'm doing that to aforehand, or whatever it is. What that means is in advance or anticipation of. Something is going to happen, so therefore, before that happens, I'm going to do something in preparation of that. That's basically what it is. So maybe, like, you know, if you were working the restaurant industry, you had the food prep in the morning or maybe the night before. You're doing it aforehand because people are going to come eat later or tomorrow. So what I see right here is this shows faith. Jesus says that she's doing it aforehand to the burial. Jesus at this point was not dying. He was not terminal. There was nobody hunting him down. He had lived 33 years, and sometimes people would seek after him, but he always got away. Not a hair from his head had fallen and hit the ground yet, and she has done this because he was going to die and be buried. He has done this aforehand. And you think about this. This is really interesting. Let's go to Good Friday. Let's go to the time where Jesus dies on the cross. Remember what happened? The storm came in. The dark clouds came in. They got the big old hammer. They went to the guy on the left side of Jesus, whacked him in the shins, because remember, the only thing that keeps you alive is when you keep pushing yourself up. And so if you take out the shin bones, when you're done, when the Romans are done playing with you and you've suffered enough, boom, and then you just suffocate. He goes to the guy on the other side of Jesus, boom, takes out his. They come to Jesus and they're like, thing's dead. You, spear, put a spear in there. Looks like water comes out from the side of Jesus. They're like, we don't have to break it because the Bible says he's not going to break any bones. He's dead already. Remember they took him down? There was no time. It was too late. We had to go ahead and they put him in a tomb. He never got that anointing. Do you remember Sunday morning, Easter Sunday? Remember who's there at the cross, at the tomb? Really easy trivia question in case you're ever asked this. Who's at the tomb Sunday morning? Oh, it's Mary. Oh, who was with Mary again? Do you guys remember? Mary. Oh, yeah. And who else was with Mary and Mary? Mary, that's right. And you might be confused to think, well, Mary of Bethany must have been there too. No, because these ladies came to anoint the body. Mary, the mother of Jesus, Mary Magdalene, and Mary, mother of James and Simon, but not Mary of Bethany, because I don't know where she's at. The Bible doesn't tell us where she's at, but she's not at the one place you know Jesus is not. He is not in that empty tomb, and she knew that. She anointed him ahead of time. Maybe when she was sitting at his feet, remember Martha was like, Jesus, Martha's not doing anything. You know, remember that? And it's like, no. Martha has chosen the good part. She's just staring at Jesus, listening to him. And maybe she heard the gospel and she's like, okay, I know how this is going to go down. And she anoints his body ahead of time because doesn't Jesus deserve the rites of burial? But they just put him in a tomb. There was no time. Sunday morning, Mary, and Mary came. And you know what? Mary of Bethany's not there. She's not there. We know where she wasn't. Why was this waste made? Can I tell you this? This is big. Ready for this? Serving God without faith always looks like waste. It always does. If you do anything for Jesus without faith, it's going to look like waste. Anybody in your community, your neighbors watching you leave this morning to go to church, if they don't have Christ in their hearts and they're not saved, and they look out their window, they're sipping their coffee, they're in their jammies, they're watching you get in the car, you're leaving early because of construction, and you know what they're thinking in their hearts? Oh my goodness, they are so dumb. What a waste. They're wasting their Sunday going to church. They're wasting their service to the Lord. That's what they're thinking in their heart because they don't know any better. If you do something big for Jesus and there's no faith in the lens of the eyes, they're going to look at it and go, what a waste. I said, I've been here 20 years. Man, somebody would not say this, say, you've wasted 20 years of your life serving the Lord. See, faith is trusting Jesus about the future and doing something about it today. She knew that Christ was going to die. He was going to die for her sins and our sins. She knew that, and she wanted to do something about it. So she did what she could. She got the spikenard, the most precious thing she had. She dumped it on his head to anoint him for burial. And she also knew that he was going to rise again on the third day. She watched Jesus call forth Lazarus, her brother, out of a tomb after he was stinking the tomb up for 4 days. She knew the gospel. She knew that was going to happen, and she wanted to do something about it. Now, my friends, it comes down to the idea of what we know. Jesus said, not only is he going to die for our sins, he's going to rise again to save us, but he's coming back for us someday. In fact, when he does come back for us someday, he's going to judge the whole world based on really one criteria is going to be this. Have you received the Lord Jesus Christ or have you rejected him? There is no middle ground. Because the only sacrifice God is going to take is perfection into his heaven, because heaven is perfect and he is perfect. And Jesus is the only one of us that ever lived a perfect life. And so that what he's earned, what he has ran to obtain, he says, I freely offer it to you if you'd like to take it by faith. He has taken your sins to the cross. He has paid the full penalty, paid in full. He's done it for you if you're willing to receive it. He's also lived a perfect life. He's willing to give you his righteousness. The choir was singing. It was great. I heard it today. Justified. You think about that. Now think about that when they were singing that. Justified. What's the next phrase after that? Oh, blessed thought. Is it like that? Think about this. I mean, could you imagine ever being accused in a courtroom, waiting the chair, the firing squad, life in prison, and the choir, and the jury gets up, and they're like, we find them innocent. Can you imagine what that would feel like? That's justified, placed in righteousness. Can you imagine what that'd be like? We stand before God because we know that we're found guilty of our sins, and we'll spend eternity separated from God. I mean, if that's what we've chose it in our life now. And so if we just continue on, separated from God in a lake of fire called hell, suffering eternally forever. And that's what awaits us when the judge says, justified. What a blessed thought. She saw that. I hope, friend, today you've made that decision. I hope you've trusted Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior here today. Now, that's the 3 points of what she did. That's it. I'm going to tell you just a couple things, I think, what lessons we can take from that here today. And number one, there's no lasting impact without sacrifice. You want a legacy? It's going to cost you. It cost her. I'm just saying, if you want to somehow take the philosophies of this world and I'm going to leave this world a great man, a great woman of God, but I ain't putting in the work, it ain't going to happen. It's going to cost. What I'm saying is I'm asking you to do something very dangerous. I'm asking you to say, take the entirety of your life and say, Lord, this is yours. I'm asking you to say, God, I'm going to let you be God of creation and me. You are my God now. Of all that I am, everything I have, I'm no longer God of me. You are God of me. Because until we get off the throne of our hearts and allow him to be God in our lives, we'll never leave a legacy. I'm saying that's dangerous today. If she would have kept that bottle, we wouldn't be talking about her today, would we? Oh, she would have a year's worth of salary in that bottle, though, and she probably would have died. And it probably would have been passed on to a child or a relative, and they would have squandered it off somewhere. But she took it, the most precious thing she had, and she broke it and poured it on Jesus. And while the disciples said, what a waste, Jesus says, man, you know, you guys don't even know what you're talking about, because we're still talking about her. And frankly, if I asked us all to name the 12 disciples, I bet you we probably could not do it today, most of us. But boy, we know Mary. We know her. She left a legacy. If you're going to leave a legacy, number two, be prepared for people to attack. Be prepared that people, because here's the thing about people. People fear what they don't understand. Again, you're not just going to church. A lot of people think, well, if you just go to church, you're a Christian. If you just go in a garage, you're a car. Like, it doesn't work that way, right? We're a community. We serve the church together. We all have a job to do. We give of our time, our talent, our treasures, because we believe that Jesus is worth it. And just be prepared for family members who are lost or maybe kind of wishy-washy, because there's a lot of ministries out there that kind of promote the same worldly mentality. Like, hey, you can come be a great Christian and do nothing. It doesn't work that way. It doesn't work that way. You know, you might upset the thieves in your life too. We all have thieves in our life sometimes. They want to steal our time, our talent, and our treasure. Sometimes they're like, you ever see those sharks go around and there's like those little sucker fish on them? Sometimes life has those people on you, right? And then once they can't get your time, your talent, your treasure, because you're so freely giving it to Christ, you're going to get upset the thieves in your life. But you know what? Is that really such a bad thing to get the thieves running away mad at you? People fear what they don't understand. So just be prepared. If I'm going to leave a legacy, nobody ever lived a life of legacy without having some friction. Because me having a life of legacy means I'm doing something different than what everybody else is doing. I'm swimming upstream. Everybody's going downstream. And when you're going that direction, everybody's going this direction, what you have is friction. Just be prepared for that. It's going to happen. If I want to live a life that my kids can celebrate, if I want to live a life that the church, because the books are actually all in the little back corner in the lobby. You can go through all the books. You can go to all the pastors. You can go to everybody. And Lord Terry's just coming. I get to be one of those guys that leaves a good impact here. And I hope it's like, oh, man, Pastor Acker, woo, he was awesome. I never heard him preach, but I heard he had a bow tie. And I heard that man preach. Like, he preached. Somebody told me every time he preached a funeral, people left the church. Like, that's how hard he preached. I know. That's pretty cool. I have to listen to some tapes. I think we have some tapes of him. Pastor Verna, is there any more sweet-smelling Savior than that name in this church, right? Everybody, what a great testimony. 27 years, man. I don't want to, oh, man, Pastor Acker, Pastor. Oh, yeah, Pastor Todd. Yeah. Yeah, he was here too, I guess, you know. I don't want that. Number three, don't be quick to judge another's work. Maybe somebody else is leaving their legacy. Maybe they're doing the good that God put on their heart, but not on your heart. Why are they doing what they're doing? Don't be caught like the disciples here judging another person's work because of what they're doing for Jesus. And you're probably mad at them because you know you should be doing it too, but you said no. So the Lord said, I'll find somebody else to do it then. And you're convicted. and you don't understand, and you're going, oh man, what a waste. It's funny, it used to be back in the day, it's not that way anymore, but anytime we do anything big for the church, it was always, if you spend any money, everybody's like, why are we wasting that money on a parking lot? Because we don't want our cars to crash into the craters out there, you know what I mean? Why are we putting a new roof on the church? It'll last another 6 months. Well, it's got to get done. Why are we putting money in the... Why are we doing this? And people go, why is that waste being made? Just be ready for them. They're everywhere. Don't be them. Please, don't be them. Then verse 8 again. She did what she could. Here's the invitation this morning. Of course, the invitation is if you received Jesus' sacrifice on the cross for your sins. Do you know today that you're saved? Do you know today that you're going to go before God and you're going to say, yes, I'm with Jesus. Justified, oh, blessed thought. Is there any angst in your mind at all about that decision? I want you to step out. We have our invitation. We can settle that. And trust me, you want to get that settled today. But here's the invitation. Is there good that God has placed on your heart? Is there good that God has placed on your heart? And you're like, I don't want to do it because people are going to think I'm wasteful. People are going to get mad at me. I'm going to stink the room up and people are going to be all upset. Fooey on them. Earn your legacy. Do it for Christ. Do what's for Him. Number one, what she did was fitting. What she did was good. And she did was faith-led. Now, what has God placed upon your heart? Let's stand to our feet with our eyes closed. The instrumentalists make their way. I want to encourage you today. Legacy today. You're going to have to go upstream. You're going to leave a legacy today. You're going to have to do what other people might find to be wasteful. I just wonder how many people today would be willing to do that. Willing to give their all. I didn't say it's for everybody. I said it's dangerous. I'm saying that people are going to attack sometimes. But my friends, it's worth it. For 2,000 years, we've been given the testimony of this woman. Someday we get to meet her in heaven. Why? Because she did what she could. What can you do this morning? Heavenly Father, Lord, I pray you bless this time of invitation. Lord, let you have your will and your way. And I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's go ahead and sing it out. Do the words up on the screen, gentlemen. Just as I am. Time to thank you for watching today. God's placed on my heart for our church here at Oxbow Baptist Church to be a lighthouse to our community.
We pray that the gospel is spoken to your heart. You know Christ is your Savior. But if you don't know if heaven's your home, we implore you, please reach out. We'd love to show you from the Word of God how you can become saved. We'd like to invite you, if you're watching online, if you have an opportunity to come visit us. If you have any questions or concerns, please reach out. You can always call us or email us. And if we can be a blessing to you or your family anytime, please reach out. God bless.